Ovaj video biće nastavak prošlog, pod nazivom Posle ovog videa sve postaje jasno. Ako niste pogledali, pogledajte ga obavezno. Tu smo raspravljali o razvijenju tehnologije budućnosti koja bi trebalo da objedini elektrotehnologiju sa sintetičkom biologijom i tako uspostavi potpunu kontrolu nad živim i neživim svetom na Zemlji. Šta mi znamo o tome koliko znamo? Ovo pitanje postavio sam sebi kad sam poslušao izlaganje Carol Rossin, desne ruke čuvenog raketnog inženjera Werner von Brauna, koji je SAD odveo do meseca. Naravno, ako jeste, jer ja kao, što često naglašavam, ne verujem zvaničnim informacijama ni slovo. Pogotovo kada čujem da je dotični von Braun skupljao mesečeve stene po Antarktiku pred samo poletanje na mesec. Zaista ne vidim niti jedan argument sa kojim bi me neko ubedio da im poverujem posle ovakvog događaja gde glavni i odgovorni za konstrukciju rakete gubi vreme na ledenom kontinentu u potrazi za kamenjem koje će u svakom slučaju uskoro doneti sa istog tog stvarnog meseca. Zato vam predlažem da pročešljate ovaj kanal koji upravo govori o tome i ima sjajne dokumentarce. Hoću da obradim projekat Sirius. Po projektu Sirius zaključujemo da su UFO stvarni. Verujem da je veliki broj vas već odgledao veliki deo tih intervjua jer imaju ogroman broj pregleda. Međutim, ako je projekat Sirius istina i ljudi koji iza njega stoje govore iskreno, onda sa pravom treba verovati da su Rusi, Kinezi, Amerikanci, Evropljani, pa od skora Indija u dogovorenoj zaveri skrivanja vanzemaljske rase ili preciznije neidentifikovanih letelica. Ako je to zaista istina, kako verovati bilo šta ljudima koji dogovoreno dezinformišu ljude pored očiglednog dokaza da nismo sami? To ne bilo kakvih ljudi, već četiri vele sile, Amerika, Rusija, Kina i Evropa. Ako stavimo prst na čelo, postavlja se pitanje zašto bi Rusija trpela sankcije, Kina zabranu uvoza, Evropa uslovljavanje od strane Amerike, kada mogu lako izaći sa dokazom da SAD smisleno laže svet već više od pola veka i da posjeduju dokaze o postojanju viših bića koji su po zvaničnoj nauci morala preći ogromne razdaljine i dosegnuti neshvatljive brzine, ne bi li ovde proučavale nas, ljudsku rasu. Ako su pak pomislili da je to čudanje pametno po svet, šta li su onda još pomislili da je pametnije da prećute? Šta vi mislite? Pa meni nekako deluje sve onda, zar ne? Ako je projekat Sirius tačan, sa pravom se može tvrditi da je sve laž. Počevši od veličine svemira, preko zvanične kosmologije koja naučnim putem dokazuje da drugi život može postojati, ali negde jako, jako, jako daleko. Do Einsteinove teorije svetlosti, koja nedvosmisleno ukazuje na nemogućnost putovanja brzinom svetlosti, pa ni približno, jer takvo putovanje zahtevalo bi pretvaranje materije, to jest vaše letelice, u gama zračenje. Mnogi greše pa koriste argument da fizička bića mogu doći iz druge dimenzije, što se opet kosi sa zvaničnom matematikom, koja otvara mogućnost postojanja istih, ali ne na način vremenskih kapija, već slaganja našeg svemira na drugi. Vremenske kapije su naučna fantastika i kada bi postojale, bile bi crne rupe sa toliko jakom gravitacijom da bi rastavile bilo koji oblik materije na sastavne delove, što opet dovodi do toga da je takvo putovanje nemoguće. Pa ko onda laže? Ja mislim da je najrazumnije reći lažu svi. Zato se ne treba svrstavati ni u jednu stranu, nego ih proučavati kao fenomene. Prva gospođa koju bih htio da pomenim je Donna Hare, koja je radila za nasilnog konstruktora Philco Forda. Ona govori da je lično videla senku na fotografiji oblika NLO letelice, koja ne pripada nama, i da su nasilni umetnici radili na uklanjanju istih sa zvaničnih fotografija pre puštanja u javnost. Donna, između ostalog, tvrdi da su pojedini astronauti Apollo videli vanzemaljsku letelicu, ali da im je bilo strogo zabranjeno da o njoj pričaju. Zanimljivo je da ovoj gospođi niko ništa nije zabranio, te slobodno priča o tome, iako je radila za NASA i imala pristupe strogim tajnama. Zbog ovakvih stvari najpametnije je biti sumnjičav prema svemu. Donna navodi kako je jedan od zaposlenih koji je radio na uklanjanju NLO letelica sa slika bio prestravljen upadom vojske i naređenjem da se što pre spali veliki broj slika koji pokazuje čak i NLO bića. Priča i da je imao ožiljak od udarca pištoljem u čelu, koliko je to ozbiljno. Drugi koji mi je jako zanimljiv je Carl Wolfi. Jedan od popularnijih intervjua na Sirius projektu govori da je radio u ratnom vazduhoplovstvu 1964. godine. Kaže da je imao dozvolu za jako tajne projekte u taktičkom odeljenju vazdušne komande u Virginiji i da dok je radio za NSA, bila mu je pokazana slika sa inteligentnim građevinama na mesecu koju je uslikao orbiter oko meseca pre samog Apollo programa. Zanimljivo je opet kako čovjek sa top secret ovlašćenjima tako slobodno govori o tome kako niko ne obara video niti zaplenjuje izjave ili ne do Bog uklanja Karla sa lica zemlje. E, zato je jako bitno poslušati ovaj ključni intervju sa Carol Rosin, čija se priča razlikuje od svih drugih u Sirius projektu. Meni se tako čini, a vidjet ćete i zašto. Njena priča govori o jasnom planu malog broja ljudi koji zarađuje ogromne pare kroz američku vojsku sa 4 jasna plana o nepostojećem neprijatelju na osnovu koga bi se odobravao ogroman budžet za vojsku. 4 neprijatelja po redosledu: Rusija, terorizam, zemlje trećeg sveta, UFO ili asteroidi. Između ostalo kaže da je NLO ultimativni cilj za ulaganje u svemirsko naoružanje, preskupo u svakom smislu, a bilo bi izvedeno isceniranom invazijom NLO-a. Ali ajde da poslušamo, ova žena je bila desna ruka čuvenog Wernher von Brauna. Intervju jeste malo dugačak, ali stvarno sam razmišljao, ako bilo šta izbacim iz njega, nećemo imati tu završnu logiku koja mi je jako bitna da bi na kraju pričali o i možda povezali čitavu sliku oko Sirius projekta, pa i priča koju priča ova žena.
When I was a corporate manager of Fairchild Industries in 1974 through 77, I met the late Dr. Wernher von Braun in early 74. At that time, von Braun was dying of cancer, but he assured me that he would live a few more years in order to tell me about the game that was being played, that game being the effort to weaponize space, to control the Earth from space and space itself. He asked me to be his spokesperson, to appear on occasions when he was too ill to speak. And I did. And what he asked me to do was to educate decision makers and the public about why we shouldn't be putting weapons in space, why they're dangerous, destabilizing, too costly, unnecessary, untestable, unworkable idea, and what the alternatives are, how we could be building a cooperative space system. What was most interesting to me was a repetitive sentence that he said to me over and over again, and that was how we identify an enemy. The strategy that Wernher von Braun taught me was that first the Russians are going to be considered to be the enemy. In fact, when I met him in 74, they were the enemy, the identified enemy. We were told that they had killer satellites. We were told that they were coming to get us and control us, the dirty commies, that whole story. First, the Russians were the enemy against whom we're going to build space-based weapons. Then terrorists would be identified, and that was soon to follow. We heard a lot about terrorism. Then we were going to identify third world country crazies. We now call them nations of concern. But he said that would be the third enemy against whom we would be needing to build space-based weapons. And the next enemy was asteroids. Now, at this point, he kind of chuckled the first time he said it. Asteroids, against asteroids, we're going to build space-based weapons. So it was funny then. And the funniest one of all was against what he called aliens, extraterrestrials. That would be the final card. And over and over and over, during the 4 years that I knew him and was giving his speeches for him, he would bring up that last card. And remember, Carol, the last card is the alien card. We're going to have to build space-based weapons against aliens. And all of it, he said, is a lie. A lie. I think I was too naive to know at that time the seriousness of the nature of the spin that was being put on the system. And now the pieces are starting to fall into place. We're building a space-based weapon system based on a premise that is a lie, a spin. What he told me was is that there's an accelerated effort in place. He didn't mention a timeline, but he said that it was going to be speeding up faster than anybody could possibly imagine. That the effort to put weapons in space was not only based on a lie, but would accelerate past the point of people even understanding it until it was already up there and too late. I've been tracking the space-based weapons issue for about 26 years. I have debated generals, congressional representatives. I've testified before the Congress and the Senate. I've met with people in over 100 countries. And I have not been able to identify who the people are who are making this space-based weapon system happen. I see the news. I see the administrative decisions being made. I know that they're all based on lies and greed. And I have yet to be able to identify who the people are. And that's after tracking this issue for 26 years. I know that there are big secrets being kept. And I know it's time that the public and decision makers pay attention to the people who are now going to be disclosing the truth. I have concluded that it's based on a few people making a lot of money and gaining power. It's about ego. It's not about our essence and who we really are on the planet and loving each other and being at peace and cooperating, using technologies to solve problems and heal people in the planet. It isn't about that. It's about a few people who really are playing an old, dangerous, costly game for their own pocketbooks and power struggle. That's all it is. And I believe that this entire space-based weapons game is initiated right here in the United States of America. But right now, there are a lot of people benefiting. This is what our economy has been based on in this country and spreading around the world. War, and people suffer as a result. It's not fair, it never has been. People have screamed for, let's build out of swords, let's make plowshares, let's have peace and hold hands around the world, but it hasn't worked because too many people are benefiting. Not only are they benefiting financially, but from what my experience is, there are people who actually believe that Armageddon should happen, so we have to have these wars. So it's going from the pocketbook to the religious right. Some people who actually believe that we have to have wars for these religious reasons. And there are people who just love war. I have met warriors who love to go to war. And then there are the good people, the soldiers, who just take orders. And they have to feed their children and send them to college, so they want to keep their jobs. People in laboratories have told me they don't want to work on these technologies for war, but if they don't, they won't get a paycheck. Who's going to pay them? In 1977, I was at a meeting in Fairchild Industries in a conference room called the War Room. And in that room were a lot of charts on the walls with enemies, identified enemies, names that people had never heard of, names like Saddam Hussein and Gaddafi. But we were talking then about terrorists, the potential terrorists. No one had ever talked about this before, but this was the next stage after the Russians against whom we were going to build space-based weapons, these terrorists. And I stood up in this meeting and I said, excuse me, why are we talking about these potential enemies against whom we're going to build space-based weapons if in fact we know that they are not the enemy at this time? And they continued the conversation about how they were going to antagonize these enemies and that at some point there was going to be a war in the Gulf, a Gulf war. Now this is 1977. This is 1977. And they were talking about creating a war in the Gulf region when there was $25 billion in the space-based weapons program that yet had not been identified. It wasn't called the Strategic Defense Initiative, at least, until 1983. This weapon system then had obviously been going on for some time that I didn't know anything about. So I stood up in this meeting in 1977 and it said, I'd like to know why we're talking about space-based weapons against these enemies. I'd like to know more about this. Would somebody tell me what this is about? Nobody answered. They went on with this meeting as though I hadn't said anything. And suddenly I heard myself stand up in the room and say, if nobody can tell me why you were planning a war in the Gulf when there's a certain amount of money in a budget so that you can create the next set of weapon systems that will be the beginning of the sell to the public about why we need space-based weapons. Consider this my resignation, and you will hear from me again. And nobody said a word, because they were planning a war in the Gulf, and it happened exactly as they planned it, on time. The room was filled with people in the revolving door game. There were people that I had seen once in a military uniform and other times in a gray suit and an industry outfit. And they revolved themselves through these doors and right into government positions. I see them then getting jobs in the government. They're affiliated with the intelligence community and or universities. This is the military-industrial complex, and they are in revolving door jobs. In about 1990, I was sitting in my living room. I said to my husband, I am now going to stop everything. I'm going to stop and sit and watch CNN television, and I'm going to wait for the war to happen. And my husband said, well, you've finally gone over the lid. You have flipped out. Friends said, you have really gone too far this time. There is not going to be a war in the Gulf. Nobody's talking about a war in the Gulf. And I said, there is going to be a war in the Gulf. I'm going to sit here and wait for the war in the Gulf. And it happened, right on schedule. As part of the war game in the Gulf, of course, we were told, we the public, that the United States was successfully shooting down Russian Scud missiles. And we were rationalizing new budgets based on that success. In fact, we found out later, after the budgets were approved for the next phase of weapons, that it was a lie. We did not have the technology. We did not have successful shoot-downs the way we were told. It was all a lie, just to get money, more money, put in the budgets to make more weapons. I was one of the first people to go independently to Russia when I heard that they had killer satellites. And when I went to Russia in the early 70s, I found out they didn't have killer satellites. That was a lie. And in fact, the Russian leaders and people wanted peace. They wanted to cooperate with the United States and the people of the world. Another time I called Saddam Hussein when he was lighting his oil fields on fire. And I got a call back from his first attaché with Saddam Hussein nearby, I was told, saying, are you a reporter? Are you an agent? Why do you want to know? And I said, no, I'm just a citizen who helped to start the movement to prevent the weaponization of outer space. And I have found that a lot of the stories that I've been told about weapon systems and the enemies are not true. So I wanted to find out what Saddam Hussein wants, what would satisfy him to have him stop making these oil fields go on fire and stop antagonizing people. And he said, well, nobody's ever asked him that question, what he wants. So when I hear that there's a possible threat of extraterrestrials, based on my own personal experience of having worked in the military-industrial complex on weapon systems and military strategy, I'm going to know it's a lie. It's a lie. Wernher von Braun gave me the assignment of preventing the weaponization of outer space from happening. But what he said to me over and over again was that his real concern, his greatest concern, was about psychotronic weapons.
Did he discuss what those were?
No. He didn't discuss what they were, but he repeated over and over to me that this was the real concern. This is what we should really be concerned about. But he would add, the public, however, won't understand that yet. So let's just call for the ban on space-based weapons. That can be understood, it can be measured, it can be done. And once you have a ban on space-based weapons, you've put a lid on the arms race. People have become aware, they've become connected consciously, and they will begin to understand that there are alternatives. But his real concern, the biggest concern he had, was about the psychotronic weapons. Those are mind-controlled weapons, mind-controlled people or technology. Very dangerous weapons. The first big speech that I gave for Wernher von Braun was in July of 1974. It was soon after I had met him, just a few months after I had met him. He gave me the assignment of speaking in Chicago at McCormick Hall to 18,000 people. What he said to me was, however, I'm going to send you 5 books in a taxi cab, take these pink index cards and take some notes, and you will introduce a live satellite demonstration. I had no idea what he was talking about. And he said, but that's not a worry either. Don't worry, you don't have to really read all of these books because I'm going to transmit the speech to you. And I said, how are you going to transmit the speech to me? You're going into the hospital. And he said, I'm going to transmit it as though you're talking on the telephone. Well, I memorized the best I could these little pink index cards, and I got up on the stage. There were 18,000 people in front of me. I had no idea what I was going to say because I couldn't see the pink index cards because I was perspiring and it was dripping down my face. When suddenly I heard in my left ear Wernher von Braun talking to me like he was talking on the telephone. And he transmitted this speech to me, the entire speech, for 35 minutes in my left ear. And I was just repeating what he was saying. But he was in a hospital bed on the East Coast, and I was in Chicago with nothing, no technology in my ear, standing in front of 18,000 people, listening to him transmit this speech. It was amazing.
Did he ever relate to you how that affected?
No, he laughed when I asked him. He thought it was funny. When Wernher von Braun transmitted into my left ear this entire speech from the East Coast of Chicago, it became very obvious to me that we humans have absolutely no idea except what we're told by people who are making money on the next levels and phases of technological developments that we are purchasing as consumers what is possible. That became very clear to me as I started actually integrating the fact that he had transmitted the speech to me and it was real. And I didn't go public about that for years because I knew that people would not believe me. They would think that this was completely insane.
I neverovatno, zar ne? Najjeziviji deo bio mi je kada je rekla da je slušala Wernher von Brauna u levom uhu bez ikakve tehnologije 70. neke godine. Da li ona to govori o bežičnoj tehnologiji bez upotrebe zvučnika kao prenosa signala? Da li se ovdje radi o telekinezi kojem je vladao Wernher ili možda čitav top secret establishment još tih godina? Po reakciji Carol i onoga kada kaže da postoje stvari za koje ne sanjamo da postoje, govore upravo u tom pravcu. Međutim, primetili ste da je von Braun zahtevao od Carol da se pozabavi i pokuša da spriječi tu prevaru o 4 neprijatelja koji za cilj imaju dozvolu za trošenje ogromnog bogatstva na odbranu. Kako Carol navodi, više puta je ponavljao ta četvrta karta, ta finalna karta lažnih vanzemaljaca koji će ostvariti budžet za svemirsko oružje. Recite, kako onda verovati da čitav establishment koji je imao upliv u velike tajne, a koji je pričao za projekat Sirius, nije upravo jedan od scenarija ostvarenja tog lažnog neprijatelja u vidu NLO, gdje plaćeni vojni radnici u penziji rade na propagiranju priče o postojanju NLO u blizini zemlje, kako bi se ljudi polako navikavali na priču o tome, dok jednog dana ne dođe taj dan za lažnu invaziju i razlog za sklapanje svemirske odbrane. Te iz tog razloga smeju da pričaju o tome javno, a da im biro ne pokuca na vrata. Postavite pitanje sami sebi. Radili ste sa ljudima na strogo očuvanim projektima, a sada tek tako pričate o njima bez ikakvih konsekvenci. Deluje li to realno? Zaista mi se izlaganje gospođe Carol nikako ne uklapa u projekat Sirius. Smisao njenog izlaganja je da se sprema lažna invazija, lažni neprijatelji svemira koji bi odobrio novčana sredstva i širenja vojske van zemlje. Pa zašto bi verovao onda u čitav pregršt svedoka i Sirius projekta koji govore u prilog da su vidjeli NLO, a radili su za istu tu vojsku koja planira zaveru u 4 koraka? Jesam li ja lud ili meni ovde nešto ima. Primetio sam da Carol održava radio show emisije sa glavnim čovekom iz projekta Sirius, Stevenom Greerom. To je ovaj čovek sa slike. Da me ljudi pogrešno ne shvate, niko ne spori da u ogromnom kosmosu, ako je tačan, moraju postojati još neka inteligentna bića. Ali mi ovde govorimo o ljudima koji tvrde da su oni već tu, da kruže oko nas, posmatraju nas. Ta činjenica zahtjeva ipak reviziju nauke i svih naučnih podataka koji nam se serviraju i na osnovu kojih je razvijena čitava tehnologija za široku ljudsku našu, civilnu primjenu. Sa jedne strane, Carol nas upozorava na isceniranu opasnost od vanzemaljaca, a sa druge pripada projektu bivših zaposlenih u vojsci koji otkrivaju ljudima istinu o postojanju istih. Kako spojiti Carol sa ostatkom Sirius projekta, ja nemam pojma. Jer ako je istina ovo što pričaju, pa onda su NLO stvarnost i onda zaista postoji neka teoretska opasnost od takvih bića, te stoga vojska s pravom ulaže pare i ne vidim zašto bi se sprečavalo svemirsko oružje. U tom kontekstu, ako me razumete. Zanimljivo mi je kako Wernher von Braun nije odao niti jednu tajnu svojoj pomoćnici, jer se navodno plašio za svoj život, za život u kome je svakog časa umirao od raka. Međutim, iza Carol postoji ipak jedna strana medalje koja je tačna. Zaista su se ostvarili i Rusija i terorizam i zemlje trećeg sveta, a sudeći po ogromnom broju ljudi koji veruju u posećivanje i otmice, više rase ostvaruje se i četvrti posljednji scenario iz svemira. Prosto mi nije jasno kako Carol ne posumnja da je projekat Sirius zapravo samo vid ostvarivanja tog plana, već nasuprot tome sarađuje sa njima i biva njihov član u neku ruku. U svakom slučaju, jako je teško razlučiti šta je danas istina. Zapravo ne smemo ni zamerati ovakvim ljudima, jer i oni možda imaju neku informaciju koja njima deluje realna i iskrena, te zaista veruju u nju. A opet ne možemo ni znati da li je ta informacija u suštini puštena kao dezinformacija o kojoj treba da se priča, gdje ljudi prirodno osjećaju da prenose iskrenu i istinitu informaciju, iako u suštini ne znaju taj njen lažni početak koji je tu da u stvari predstavlja dezinformaciju. Bavit ćemo se mi ovim još jako puno, jer imamo jako puno vremena pred nama. Istraživat ćemo, pokušavat ćemo da shvatimo barem smisao svega, smisao svih tih dvosmislenih priča koje se pričaju. Voli vas Ves, pozdrav, dobri ljudi.